Hello class 10th, welcome to the second part of lesson 17, that is public revenue. And as you all know, we are using the Oswal publishers of class 10th. Okay students, so before we get into the lesson, I just want you to know the topics that we are going to cover today. So first of all, we will talk about GST, and GST stands for goods and service tax. So we will discuss about that. We will see its objective. We'll also see the other kinds of taxes apart from direct and indirect tax. Okay, so all the taxes that are apart from direct and indirect tax, we will consider them now in this video and we'll see their meanings. Alright, so students, let's get started. Now, the first thing is goods and service tax. Like I already told you that this is what we are going to study. Now, basically this Goods and Service Act was passed in the Parliament on the 29th of March 2017. Basically, GST is considered as the value addition at each stage, and it is a tax that is levied on manufacture, sale and consumption of goods and services at the national level. So therefore, GST is something, it is like, in other words, we can say it is the biggest tax reform that took place in India, and it was actually launched in India from the 1st of July 2017. So it was passed in the Parliament on 29th March 2017, but it came into effect on 1st July 2017, and since then it is very much active. Alright, the next thing is that goods and services are organized under the 5 tax slabs. So there are 5 different tax slab categories under which the tax is taken. So one is 0%, completely zero, that means nil. Okay, and next is 5%, then it is 12%, then the next bracket is 18%, and then 28%. Okay, so a zero tax rate will apply to 50% of the items in the consumer price index. Okay, so about 50% of all the commodities that a consumer is consuming will have 0% tax rate, and other goods and services apart from the 50% will have the different tax slabs for collection of tax. That will be 5%, 12%, 18% and 28%. Okay students, now we will see the list of all the taxes that have been replaced by GST. That means there are some taxes that were being taken earlier, but now GST has combined to become one kind of a tax and has replaced all those taxes. So the first one is central excise duty, then it is the service tax. These taxes that I'm telling you, we used to pay them separately, but now because of GST we are paying them as one tax, that is GST. Then CES was actually a tax system which was also known as tax on tax. So basically it was a system where it was considered that it is a form of tax that is charged or levied over the tax. There's already a tax, on that tax also you pay a tax, that was CES. Okay, so basically CES was usually enforced, or we can say it was imposed additionally, when the central government or maybe even the state government, they were wanting to raise the funds for specific purposes. Like, I'll give you an example. For example, the government levies an education cess in order to generate additional revenue for funding the primary, secondary and higher education. So taking cess or a tax on already a tax, that is cess. Okay, so CES is not a permanent source of revenue for the government, and it is something that is levied on both direct as well as indirect taxes. Okay, so we cannot say that it is on for a particular kind of tax, but it is for both direct as well as indirect. Then we also have the state VAT. If you all remember VAT, we used to give the value added tax. That was also something that has been replaced by GST. Then central sales tax, then purchase tax, then we had the entertainment tax, then after entertainment tax we also have octroi. Actually, octroi must be a new word for you people. So let me just tell you what octroi actually means. Basically, octroi is, it is a local tax that is collected on some commodities that are brought into your district or your state. Okay, so some commodities that are coming to your state or coming to your district, they carry tax on them. So you have to pay tax for those kinds of commodities that are entering your state or that are, you know, entering your district. Okay, so that is called octroi. So it's mostly like a local kind of a tax. Okay, it's not a state or central kind of a tax. It's more like a local tax. Then you have taxes on advertisements, and there are lots more, kinds of taxes that have been replaced by GST. Now, students, we are going to look into the objectives of GST. Why do you think GST came into existence? So there are four main reasons why we can say we can also call it the four main benefits of GST, or we can call them objectives and aims of GST, and we can also consider them as the reasons why it was important for GST to be to come into existence. So the first point is to eliminate multiple taxes. Now, I already showed you a list of so many taxes, and to avoid, or we can say to eliminate so many taxes, the government brought into action as GST, that is one particular tax. Okay, so GST was actually launched in order to remove the multiple taxes. So basically what they did, they tried to merge a large number of central as well as state taxes into a single tax. So this has actually helped in reducing any kind of double taxation, which we also call cascading. So any kind of double taxation, that means a similar kind of taxation, a sales tax and maybe a central sales tax or something that becomes pretty similar, and a double sort of a tax is paid. To avoid such multiple taxes, GST came into existence. Then is to reduce overall tax burden. So another objective, or we can say another benefit of GST is, or it was, to reduce the overall tax burden on the goods and services. So basically this will benefit the common man, people like us. We are benefited because an overall burden has been removed. So it's just one kind of tax that we are going to pay, and this will reduce the prices of goods and services. So earlier, because of so many varieties of taxes, the price of the goods and services was pretty high. But now, because there's just one kind of a tax that we are paying, therefore it has pretty much reduced the cost, the price of the goods and services. The next objective is to boost up economic growth. So basically, introducing GST would also help the Indian products pretty competitive. It makes it pretty competitive in the international as well as in the domestic kinds of markets. So this would really help the economic growth of our country. A faster GDP growth will take place when the tax will be one, and it will help Indian commodities to get into a competition, because there are not too many taxes that we have to pay. So automatically these commodities will come into a competition in the international as well as domestic market, and such a competition will help them to gain a lot of profit, and ultimately it will just boost up the income of the country. And we can also say, in other words, the economic growth or the GDP growth, that is the gross domestic product, or in other words we can also call it the national income. And the last objective is to improve tax compliance. Okay, so GST was implemented to rationalize the tax structure. Okay, in order to very logically think of the tax structure, this GST came into existence. Okay, and GST has not just removed multiple taxes and the burden and boosted the economic growth, but it has also simplified the procedures related to tax system. So it is pretty simplified. It is very, very simplized, and we don't have too much calculations now. So it's pretty simple and easy. Okay, so this has improved the tax compliance. So all services like registrations, returns, payments, etc., they would be easily available online also. And these days people are working online mostly, right? So we all have this online kind of a procedure that we have to follow, and this would make the tax payments more easier. So now you don't have to really go to the office and do all sorts of payments. You are having everything online. You can find out all the details online. So the tax systems have become very improved, very systematic and very simplified. Okay, now you're going to watch a video on GST. So I hope you enjoy watching it, and I also believe that you're going to understand GST even better.
Hello and welcome back guys, my name is Gaurav Jashnani and I am back with a very interesting and informational video on goods and services tax. GST is said to be the most revolutionary tax reform that is being undertaken since independence. It is going to replace all major indirect taxes applicable in our country. Before discussing GST, let us first understand the present tax system applicable in India. Taxes can be divided into two broad categories. First is direct taxes and second is indirect taxes. Direct taxes are taxes which are imposed on person and are paid to the government by taxpayer himself. For example, income tax. If there is liability of income tax on any person, he has to pay it directly to the government. Indirect taxes, on the other hand, are imposed on goods and services and are paid indirectly to the government via third person. For example, service tax. When you go and dine out in restaurant, you pay service tax which is included in the bill to the owner of the restaurant. That restaurant owner pays service tax portion to the government. In this way, you pay the taxes to the government via third person, so it is an indirect tax. In our country, indirect taxes are levied by central government as well as state government. Some major indirect taxes levied by central government are excise duty. It is charged on goods produced or manufactured in India. Service tax, it is charged on provision of services. Central sales tax or CST, it is charged on interstate sale of goods, that is when goods are sold from one state to another. Custom duty, it is levied on imports and exports of the goods. Some major indirect taxes levied by state government are value added tax or VAT, it is charged when goods are sold within the state. Entertainment tax, it is imposed on various forms of entertainment, example on movie tickets. Luxury tax, it is imposed on luxury hotel rooms. Octroi or entry tax, some state government levy octroi when goods enters the state. This was a quick overview of major indirect taxes imposed by center and state. If you want to have a clear understanding of present tax system, I would suggest you to watch my previous video in which I have explained everything in detail. I have provided the link in the description box below. Now let's understand what is GST. As the name suggests, it is an indirect tax levied on goods and services. It is clear that GST is an indirect tax and it is not going to have any impact on rates or structure of direct taxes, which means income tax rates and its levy will remain same. The reason it will be a game changer once implemented is because GST will replace major indirect taxes that are levied by center and state. What does it mean? Taxes such as excise duty, service tax, VAT, luxury tax, entertainment tax will all be replaced by goods and services tax. There will be two parts of GST. First is central GST or CGST and second is state GST or SGST. All central level indirect taxes except custom duty will be replaced by CGST and state level indirect taxes will be replaced by SGST. Now let's talk about some benefits of GST. Economists say the new system could add at least 2% to India's GDP and that should help keep India's economy moving. Some major benefits of GST are: it will replace all major indirect taxes. We have already discussed GST is going to replace all major indirect taxes imposed by state and center. It will remove cascading effect. Cascading effect is a situation where taxes imposed on previously charged taxes. In simple words, it means tax on tax. A product on which excise duty has been charged can also be liable to VAT. Let's say a manufacturer produces certain item for ₹100. He charges excise duty at 12% and sells it to shopkeeper for ₹112. That shopkeeper sells the same item to the consumer after charging VAT at the rate of 12.5%. In this case, VAT charged by dealer is ₹14. This ₹14 has two components. One is ₹12.50, which is on the cost of the goods, and second is 1.50, which is charged on excise duty. In this case, VAT is charged on excise duty component also, and consumer has to bear this additional burden. This is called cascading effect. GST will remove cascading effect as there will be only a single tax applicable. GST will reduce flow of black money in the country. Black money refers to funds on which taxes have not been paid. There are persons who understate income by not reporting each and every transaction. By doing this, they save indirect taxes and more importantly are able to furnish under reporting of their incomes. GST is single tax on supply of goods and services right from manufacturer to the consumer. Credits of input tax at each stage will be available in subsequent stage of value addition. To get the credit of previously paid taxes, everyone will insist upon getting the invoice for the transaction. GST will have a paper trail which can be accessed by the income tax department. Users of PAN and Aadhaar will be required to file GST returns. This will help the income tax department to track transactions. In my view, this is the beginning of new era where corruption will gradually subside. One India, one market. GST will facilitate Make in India by making one India. There are dozens of taxes that prevent India from becoming a common market. Under GST, a single tax will be imposed all over the country on production, sales and services, turning India into a common market. Seamless flow of goods across nation. On many occasions, you might have seen a long line of trucks on both sides of state's border. These rows of trucks, sometimes running into miles, have to pay entry tax or octroi. Every time goods are moved from one state to another, taxes are paid at border. These taxes are collected by individual states. Imagine a situation where trucks has to pass multiple states. According to Road Ministry study, a typical truck spends nearly 16% of time at check posts or at toll plazas, including up to pay tax only to pass through a state. There is also a central sales tax or CST for interstate movement of goods. Consignor has to show various documents relating to CST at the state border. Some manufacturers do not supply goods in other states because of CST and octroi. GST will result in easier transportation of goods from one state to another by replacing CST and octroi. GST will reduce transportation and logistic costs to the great extent. Ease of doing business. Apart from having a common market, there will be a lot of ease of doing business in India. At present, a businessman has to get registered with various tax authorities, maintain many papers, and file different tax returns to different tax authorities. After the implementation of GST, there will be a single registration, single return, and less paperwork. The businessman will be able to put his time and energy into doing business rather than complying with various tax laws. Now let's come to most important part of GST, which is rate of GST. Government has recently announced the rates of new GST regime. There will be four main tax slabs ranging from 5% to 28% under goods and services tax. These four rates are 5%, 12%, 18% and 28%. According to government, essential items including food items will be taxed at 0%. The lowest 5% rate would be for commonly used items, while 12% and 18% will be two standard rates. The highest 28% will be applicable on luxury items. Now let's have a look how it is going to impact a common man. In the current non-GST regime, indirect taxes on goods are 27 to 32% of the cost of goods in general and about 15% of cost of services. However, once GST comes into effect, the cost of goods is likely to come down while the cost of services will rise. But overall tax burden on the consumer is likely to reduce in general. There are certain items on which GST will not be applicable. For example, alcohol, tobacco, petroleum products, tax on electricity bills are some of the items on which GST will not be applicable. These items will retain their current tax structure. I have tried to cover all major aspects of GST in this short video. If you have any queries about GST, then please drop in your comments in the comments box below. Thanks very much for watching this video, and please hit like button if you find this video helpful, and don't forget to subscribe my channel to stay updated with tax and other financial issues. That's all I have for you today. This is Gaurav Jashnani signing off. See you soon in my next video.
Okay students, now we will see another kind of tax, that is the specific and the ad valorem tax. Now first of all we are going to look into specific tax. Now what is a specific tax? Basically specific taxes are those taxes which are imposed on the weight or on some external measure of the commodity. I'll give you an example. For example, let's say we are taking tax on sugar. Now what do you think you are taking tax on sugar? You are taking tax on sugar on the basis of the units of weight, right? Like for example, how many kgs is it? Is it 100 kgs or 500 kgs or whatever? Whatever measurement or the weight of the commodity is, on that when you take the tax, or on that when taxes are imposed, they are considered to be specific taxes. Next is the ad valorem tax. Now what is an ad valorem tax? This must be a very new term for all of you. So please listen to me carefully. Now when taxes are imposed on the basis of value of commodities, then they are called ad valorem tax. Okay, now again I'll give you an example for this. Let's imagine we'll take an example of import and export. Okay, so import or export duties are actually levied in terms of value. So taxes on the imported or exported goods have nothing to do with the size or with the length or with the weight of the commodity. Okay, whatever you're importing, whatever you're exporting, you are taking a tax on the value of that commodity. How much worth is the commodity. So what is the worth of the commodity? You take a tax on that in case of ad valorem tax. You're not taking tax on the basis of weight, size or length in case of ad valorem tax. Alright students, let's move on. Now we will see proportional and progressive kind of taxes. So first of all, let's see proportional. Proportional tax is the one in which the rate of tax remains the same. So it is simple to calculate but falls heavily on the poor in incomes as it is constant. Now what does it mean over here? I'll just give you an example. Let's say there are three individuals, A, B and C. A earns, or we can say A's income is 10,000 rupees, B's income is 15,000 rupees and C's income is 20,000 rupees. But the rate of tax for all three of them is 5%. So A is also paying 5% of his income as tax. B is also doing the same, and so also C. So when all of them are paying the same category of tax rate, they are paying the same rate of tax, that is proportional tax. See, amount will differ. Amount of tax that will go will differ, because 5% of 10,000 rupees will be 500, 5% of 15,000 rupees will be 750 rupees, 5% of 20,000 will be 1,000 rupees. So that will change, but the rate of tax will be the same. It will remain constant for everyone, and that is why we can say that it becomes a heavy burden on the poor category. Because see, it is a 5% tax rate does no harm to the rich person. That rich person can easily pay. But for a poor person earning small amount but paying 5% tax equal to how much the rich is paying, it's not justifiable. Okay, it's not correct. So that is why we say that the burden falls on the poor. The next is progressive tax. Now what is a progressive tax? Basically it is the tax when the rate of tax increases as the taxpayer's income increases. This means that the progressive tax is equitable as it is based on the ability to pay. Now, what happens in case of progressive tax? For example, again we will see the example of A, B and C. A earns 10,000 rupees, B's income is 15,000 rupees and C's is 20,000. We will keep the same amount and the same people. But the person who is earning 10,000, that is A, his tax rate is 5%, The person earning 15,000, his tax rate is 10%, and the person earning 20,000, his tax rate is 15%. So when the income of a person increases, then what happens? Income is increasing, tax rate is increasing. Now A's income is low as compared to B and C. So his tax rate is different, it's low. But when another person is earning an increased income, his tax rate is higher. So this is progressive tax, that when the rate of tax increases as that of the taxpayer's income. Okay, when taxpayer's income is increasing and and simultaneously the tax rate also increases according to the income of the person, that is progressive tax. That is why we say that progressive tax is very equitable, because in that case what will happen, the poor person who is earning less will fall in the category of less, or I can say a lower tax rate, and the person who is earning more will fall in the category of higher tax rate. Right, that is why we also call it as an equitable tax, because it is based on the principle of ability to pay. Next is regressive and digressive tax. So what is a regressive tax? Now regressive tax is when the rates of tax decrease as the tax base increases. Tax base means the income of a person. So when the rate of tax is reducing or decreasing, but the income of the person is increasing, that is a regressive tax. And we call regressive tax as very unjust and inequitable. Now we'll see how. See, one person is earning 10,000, the other earns 15,000, and the third person is earning 20,000. Now the person earning 10%, his tax rate is a person earning 10,000, his tax rate is 10%. Person earning 15,000, his tax rate is 9%, and the person earning 20,000, his tax rate is 8%. See, amount of tax will change, 100%. It will change, it will increase, but the tax rate is different. The tax rate is more for the person whose income is lower, and the tax rate is lower for the person whose income is higher. So when the tax rate is decreasing but the income of the person is increasing, of different people is increasing, that is regressive tax. Okay, so my income is, let's say, 50,000, but my tax rate is hardly 5%. But on the other hand, there is another person whose income is 10,000, but his tax rate is 12%. So his income is less, but tax rate is more, and my income is more, my tax rate is less. So when the income increases and the tax rate decreases, that is regressive tax. And the last one is digressive tax. Now digressive tax means the rate of tax will increase to a certain limit, but after a certain limit, what will happen? The rate of tax will be uniform. That means it will become constant. So in case of income tax, you will find that digressive kind of taxes are found. Okay, digressive kind of tax are found in practice in case of the income tax. So what happens in case of digressive tax? So in case of digressive tax, the rate of tax will increase to a certain limit, but later on it will become uniform. So I'll again give you an example of the person earning 10,000, then another earning 15, and the third one earning 20,000. Now the person with 10,000 salary, his tax rate is 5%. But the person with 15 and 20,000, their tax rate is 7%. So at first it was 5%, but later on the tax rate increased and became constant to 7%. Okay, so when the tax rate of tax increases for some time, from 5% it becomes 6%, then it becomes 7%, it increases for a certain limit, but then later on it becomes same for all. Okay, so it becomes uniform rate. Like for example, I already told you that two, three other incomes are having 7%. Okay, so that will be called a digressive tax. So what is a digressive tax? It is the tax rate that increases up to a certain limit, but after that it becomes uniform. So a uniform rate is charged. Alright students, I hope you all have understood this lesson. Please go through the lesson in your book as well. You will understand better. And I hope that you will follow all the things that I have given in the video, in the first as well as in the second part. Prepare only this much, because this is what is in your syllabus. The video that I am making for every lesson is having only the amount that you have to study as per the syllabus of ICSE. Alright students, enjoy the lesson and all the best.